In part two of our lesson on translations of sine and cosine graphs, you're going to learn the steps for graphing sine and cosine functions. So first, you will find the period, amplitude, phase shift, vertical shift, domain, and range for the function. And then you will use these elements to check your work as you go on in your graph, and that way you can verify that you're making your graph correctly. Second, you will find the shifted cycle by solving either form of this inequality for x. You're going to take the argument of the function and you're going to put it in an inequality between 0 and 2 pi. And you can use the factored form of the argument, or you can use the unfactored form of the argument. It doesn't matter because these are equivalent to each other. But remember what this is. This is the argument of the trig function. When you solve this inequality for x, you're going to get some interval, some starting point, and some ending point. It's not going to be 0 or 2 pi anymore. Once you solve for x, they'll be different, but you can use that starting and ending point, subtract them to make sure that that equaled the period you thought you should be getting. Once you have your starting and ending point, you can now break that shifted cycle into four equal pieces, as we've done before, and plot the five key points on your graph. So let's get started with an example. Here, we have to sketch one cycle of y equals 2 sine of the quantity 1 half x minus pi over 2 minus 1. To find the period, we know we have to do 2 pi over b. Now, to get at a, b, c, and d, a and d are easy to find here. A is going to be 2. D is going to be negative 1. Now, to get at b and c, we should write the argument of the trig function in its factored form. So this is going to be 2 times the sine of, we're going to factor out the 1 half. So if I'm multiplying by a half on the outside, just take every term on the inside and multiply times 2 to counteract that. So if I factor the half out of here, think of multiplying this times 2, it becomes x. Then we have a minus sign. Take this and multiply times 2, and you get pi. And then there's minus 1. Or you can think of this as plus negative 1. Same thing. So you can either write this as minus 1, or you can think of it as plus negative 1. Now, you should always double check your factoring. 1 half times x is 1 half x. 1 half times pi is pi over 2. So we know we've factored correctly. So now we can see that b, letter b here for finding our period, is equal to 1 half. So we've got 2 pi divided by 1 half, and that's going to equal 4 pi. So the period of this function is 4 pi. That's how long it takes from start to end. The amplitude is going to be the absolute value of a, and we can see that a is equal to 2, so we're taking the absolute value of 2, which of course is 2. The phase shift is equal to letter c, and to get at letter c, we have to use this factored form, and we know that c is whatever comes after the minus sign, so c is actually positive pi, which means the shift will be to the right. The vertical shift is letter D, which we know is negative 1, which means it's going to be a shift downward. The domain of every sine and cosine is negative infinity to positive infinity, because the graph goes forever and ever in the positive direction and forever and ever in the negative direction. Now the range we can compute. We know that the range of sine starts off negative 1 to 1, and it will be affected by the amplitude, which we know is 2. So that would turn it into negative 2 to positive 2. And then it will be affected by the vertical shift, which we know is negative 1. So then that means if I'm at negative 2 and I go down by 1, I'm going to be at negative 3. If I'm at positive 2 and I go down by 1, then I'm going to be at positive 1. So when we make our graph, we expect that the range should work out to be negative 3 to positive 1. And in fact, all of these attributes of the graph would be something that you want to verify as you go through your work and do. These help you catch any errors you might be making along the way. Next, we have to solve the inequality to find the shifted cycle. We can use either form of the argument, either the unfactored original form that we had or the factored form that we created. It doesn't matter which one. I tend to use the unfactored form. I think it's a little easier to work with. But remember, you always start out saying 0 is less than or equal to the argument of your function is less than or equal to 2 pi, because this is a sine graph. So we know that the argument of our function is 1/2 x minus pi over 2. And just a reminder, you could also use the other factored form, which is 1/2 times the quantity x minus pi. Totally fine to use that form as well. And then the third element, less than or equal to 2 pi. So the first thing we're going to need to do is add pi over 2 to all three pieces. The first piece is pi over 2, less than or equal to, in the middle here, these two are going to cancel out, and we have 1/2 x less than or equal to. We need to get a common denominator here. We know that 2 pi is the same as 4 pi over 2. So if we have 4 pi over 2 plus pi over 2, now we're at 5 pi over 2. We want to get x by itself, so we're going to multiply through by 2 every piece of the inequality. And we end up with pi is less than or equal to x is less than or equal to 5 pi. So we know that our graph is going to start with an x value of pi, and it's going to end at an x value of 5 pi. And this is where I'm talking about you can verify the period. In your work above, we found out that the period was 4 pi, and when we look at this, we can see 5 pi minus 1 pi is 4 pi. So you've verified that the period is going to be 4 pi. We're ready to plot our 5 key points. And remember, when we solved our inequality, we found out that we're starting at pi and we're ending at 5 pi. The midpoint between 1 pi and 5 pi is going to be 3 pi. And if you're not sure, of course, then you could do the calculation. Add up pi plus 5 pi is 6 pi. Divide by 2, you get 3 pi. Now between pi and 3 pi is 2 pi. Between 3 pi and 5 pi is 4 pi. So we already have all of our x values. Now remember, our function is y equals 2 times the sine of 1 half x minus pi plus a negative 1. Or you can write that as minus 1. And here I wrote the factored form, but it would have been fine if I had written the unfactored form. But we have a sine graph here. We know that our expected y values are going to be 0, 1, 0, negative 1, 0. Because every sine graph is going to go root, max, root, min, root. Now our y values are affected by two of the coefficients in the function, and they are affected by a, which tells us we have a vertical stretch by a factor of 2. So we know that every y value is going to have to be multiplied by 2. We also know that they will be affected by the vertical shift, which is minus 1. So every y value is going to be multiplied by 2 and then subtracted by 1. So 0 times 2 is 0. 0 minus 1 is negative 1. At this y value, 1 times 2 is 2, minus 1 is 1. Here we've got 0 times 2, minus 1, minus 1. We've got negative 1 times 2 is negative 2. Negative 2 minus 1 is going to be negative 3. And we know that 0 times 2 minus 1 is negative 1. Remember that you have to show the work of checking at least one of your values. Ideally, you would check all 5, but I understand that can take a lot of time. You have to at least check one, and remember, don't pick one of the values that started off as a root. Pick one that started off as a max or a min. So let's say, for example, we're going to check this one. So we're going to take 2 pi, which is the x value. We're going to plug it in for x in the function and see what it works out to be. So we have 2 times the sine of 1 half. Now if we're plugging in 2 pi, we've got 2 pi minus 1 pi, so that's pi. And then we're going to be subtracting 1. Now we know that this is pi over 2, right? 1 half times pi is pi over 2. The sine of pi over 2 is equal to 1. And then we have to subtract 1. So 2 minus 1 is equal to 1. And that exactly matches what we expected to get. So we can feel pretty confident moving forward and plotting the 5 key points on our graph now. Looking at our x values, we see that we can go by pi on our x-axis. So we would have pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi, and 5 pi. In the y direction, we see our smallest y value is negative 3. Our biggest y value is positive 1, so it looks like we can go by 1s. So this will be 1. We've got negative 1, negative 2, and negative 3. And now we can go ahead and plot our points. We've got pi negative 1, 2 pi 1, 3 pi negative 1, 4 pi negative 3, and 5 pi negative 1. We connect with smooth curves. And there's our graph. Now, one of the things you'll want to do when you finish your graph is verify that all of these attributes are true. We can see the period is 4 pi because we've got 5 pi minus pi is 4 pi. The amplitude is 2. When you're looking at a graph and measuring its amplitude, you can think of this center line here where the roots moved to. And the amplitude is going to be the distance from the center line out to the max and min. So from this center line, if we go up, we see that's a distance of 2. Or from the center line, if we go down, we see that's a distance of 2. That's our amplitude. Now the phase shift, we expected that the graph would move pi to the right. And indeed, we verify that it did, because normally sine should have its first root starting over here on the y-axis. But instead, it moved over to the right by pi, and it's starting here. So that worked out. The vertical shift should be down by 1. The easiest way to see the vertical shift is look for the center line of the graph, because normally it's the x-axis, and we can see instead the center of the graph is down here at negative 1, which means we had a downward shift by 1. The domain, we know this is just one little piece of the graph. We know it would go on forever and ever in both directions. The range should have worked out to be negative 3 to 1, and we can verify that on the graph. The smallest y value is negative 3, the biggest y value is 1.